Hello everyone. This is Medha. I hope you can hear me.
Yes, we can hear
Yes,
you.
Medha.
Okay, great. Thanks very much. It's always good to hear because I don't know if I'm talking into a complete void. Welcome, and I'm glad you guys could attend. There's quite a good group here. I just want to introduce, I think you all know Pythagoras probably. But I just want to quickly introduce him. He is the lead developer for GARDIAN and has been involved with the project for quite some time, since the inception really, since for about 2 years now. We thought it would be helpful for him to talk a little bit more about the FAIR guidelines and their application in GARDIAN. I know several people have had questions about this. It's something that has been of interest to others outside CGIAR as well. So it seemed like we should follow up the October presentation that Pythagoras did to our group in Naivasha with sort of a more focused presentation perhaps. So with that, I'm just going to let Pythagoras introduce himself quickly, talk a little bit about where, you know, what his interests are, what his background is, and then launch into the presentation. Pythagoras, over to you.
First of all, can you hear me clearly?
Yeah, a little bit louder would probably be helpful though.
Okay, I will talk a little bit louder. So my name is Pythagoras Karampiperis. I'm within this effort of shaping up a GARDIAN from the early beginning. I am the CEO of a relatively small company, SCiO, located in Greece, and we focus on big data analytics, data management, and digital transformation for agriculture and for food systems. Today's webinar will focus on FAIR, what is FAIR, how GARDIAN applies FAIR guidelines, FAIR principles, and what are the main rules, the main guidelines that a data manager should follow. So as for GARDIAN to meet its guidelines. The idea behind FAIR is that FAIR is an evolution of the open data concept. Before some years ago, we were discussing about open data, making data open. FAIR goes many steps beyond the idea of opening data, focusing on also other aspects that we will see later on. This aims in principle to facilitate reusability of data across the different stakeholders. And the new thing is that except from human actors, FAIR also targets machines. So it is FAIR tries to describe data, to provide metadata, provide the technology that not only humans can find, access, and reuse, but also the machines. So ultimately, humans via search engine can find more data. Humans, so as for humans to be easier to identify if they have rights and which rights they have when they have data in their hand, because the machines can understand some things. And also humans have more flexibility in reusing data because the data have been described in an interoperable way. And these are mainly the dimensions that FAIR data principles introduce. Findability, so as to make a resource discoverable. Accessibility, which talks about the licensing and the terms of use of a specific data, that dataset, publication, whatever. Interoperability, which means that the resource should be easily used via different tooling. And the fourth one, reusability, which actually means that the resource can be found, accessed, and used in different contexts. And this reminds this fourth dimension, although it is really, really important, because eventually this is the ultimate goal, that the dataset is produced once and it is used in different contexts by many researchers and all these nice things. Actually, it's the most difficult dimension, as we will see later on, for a machine to interpret, and it is highly dependent on the other three dimensions. So why FAIR? Why there is this discussion about FAIR, and why this is important? It is important because except from having open data, having data that can be reused promotes reproducibility of science. It helps data use at scale by machines and also by human, and it enhances, it provides new paradigms and promotes sharing innovation and accelerates scientific discovery. So it is important to go this this way beyond just opening. If I open something that nobody can reuse in a closed format, in if I just take a screenshot of a huge Excel file, for example, and I publish a picture of it, nobody can use it, or it's really, really difficult to reproduce it so as to verify scientific results, to continue the research with different direction, and so on. So findability, accessibility, interoperability, and reusability are the four main dimensions, and these actually define the term FAIR. This came from a working group, mainly from W3C, that originally defined those principles. Here we can see what are those principles. Findability actually discusses the existence of globally unique identifiers. Also, it requires, this principle requires to have rich metadata. Accessibility deals with some protocols of authentication, some protocols of having metadata and accessibility and data in an accessible manner. Interoperability deals with existence of vocabularies following a broadly accessible language. Reusability deals with the use of community standards, of attributes that describe the user's licenses, and so on. Although we can see that in these different dimensions are clear, at least it is very easy to understand what with findability, accessibility, interoperability, and reusability means. Actually, if we go deeper and we see at least this first tries to define those dimensions, in many cases, like the existence of rich metadata, like the requirement for broadly accessible applicable language, and so on, these descriptions are somehow vague, in the sense that they are not so concrete that they can be easily described, measured, and globally agreed. So we can say that these FAIR principles, although they are distinct, they are yet related, not fully orthogonal. You can see many cases where two different principles refer to the same thing. They provide general directions for adhering them, but the terminology in many cases is a little bit vague, making this the quantification of fairness not a straightforward process, not a feasible process. So in principle, there is no approach, and I'm not sure if it has meaning to strictly measure fairness. Instead, and this is what we follow in Guardian, we try to promote fairness by providing a set of rules, a set of good practice guide that if a data manager will follow it, most probably the resource that he or she is describing will end up with a better description with regards to these four dimensions. So in Guardian, we try to promote fairness of both CGIAR publications and datasets, and we try to do that by facilitating conformance to FAIR principles. And we provide guidelines. I will provide later on in the next slides details on those guidelines that we can discuss. We provide behind the scenes many tools that try to automatically enhance fairness from for CGIAR publications and datasets. And also we provide some visual indicators for monitoring adherence to the guidelines. If you have visited Guardian, you can see for a dataset or for a publication that there is a small graphical representation about FAIR. This is not intended to be used as an assessment of fairness, although if you meet, but this expresses actually how well you meet the Guardian guidelines. But if you meet the guidelines, it is more likely to be also more fair, in the sense that if you don't meet at all the guidelines there, it is almost sure that your resource is not fair, but not necessarily the opposite. So let's go and see how the different dimension of fair is perceived from the Guardian perspective, and how internally we try to understand if a resource meets certain criteria. In each dimension, we have five conformance levels, meaning that we think that if you are in if you have reached level 4, most probably you are more findable if you are in level 1. So level 1 starts with no PIDs. PID is a persistent identifier, and some very, very basic metadata or documentation about the resource. Level 1 is always the entry level for Guardian. So the entry level for Guardian regarding findable is the existence of a URL, a title, the existence of authors, and publication date. This means that Guardian, which is an engine that goes to many, many systems across CGIAR centers and harvests and unifies all this information space. For Guardian, in order for a resource to be visible in Guardian, this resource, the metadata for this resource, should always have a URL, should always have a title, authors, and the publication date. If these criteria are not met, then this resource will never be indexed by Guardian. After that, Guardian tries to populate metadata if there is such a capacity, trying to improve the level of fairness, the level of findability here. From a data manager, this is not the expected case. The idea when you sit in front of your laptop, in front of your PC, and try to curate data, you try to do your best. So instead of targeting level 1, you have to target level 5. So we will see step by step how these different levels are perceived from Guardian perspective regarding findability. From level 1, in order to reach level 2, Level 2 is, again, it requires no persistent identifier, but has significant metadata. Significant metadata means more metadata. In order to reach this, or to reach level 2, you need also to provide in your metadata a summary, so as to be easier for humans to understand what this resource is about, and some keywords. From our perspective, we consider that the existence of four keywords is okay. Again, if you want to move from level 2 to level 3, level 3 is considers again that there is no PID, but you have extensive metadata. In order to move from level 2 to level 3, you need to add extra information. And this information deals with the country or region information that this data, that this publication is about, and also moving from three keywords to ontological terms. If you want to push it more in the findability dimension, then you need to have also a persistent identifier. You need to have an ID that uniquely identifies the resource. Typically, this can be an HDL. So if you have an HDL, or if you have published in a system like CGSpace that has handlers, has HDL handlers, then you get some extra credits for that. And if your resource has a DOI identifier, then you get additional credits. So this is something that tries very, very easily to put some basic rules, so as to be easier for a data manager to describe a resource that eventually will be more findable. And the idea so far is to start with basic metadata, to extend it with extra metadata about summary keywords, with more metadata about country, region, some ontologies, agrovoc, crop ontologies, and other ontologies depending on the domain, targeting systems that provide handlers, or a publication targeting articles, open articles that provide DOIs. And the last level for moving from level 4 to level 5 is that this resource should be published in a CGIAR center repository or in Guardian, so that the metadata or the data register or indexed are indexed in a searchable resource, in a repository that eventually a search engine like Google, like Yahoo, like Bing will come harvest and make it even findable outside the system to the outer world for everyone. And this is the logic from having findable resources behind Guardian. Just to give you some extra insights on what is what Guardian does behind the scenes, just to help the human side, all the curators that tackle with all this data stewardship a process, which is a very time-consuming and very difficult thing, especially if we think if we take into account scenarios of resources that come from different centers. There are many cases that a publication or a data set is already described by someone else, but when a data a data manager is in the curation process, he or she doesn't know it. So one thing that Guardian tries to do is deduplication, try to identify all the different records across the different systems that talk to the same thing, tries to identify uniquely those resources. It tries to consolidate the metadata from those multiple locations, including cross-ref. So if, for example, a publication or a dataset has a DOI, someone, a human, has already described, in order to get the DOI, has already provided many metadata in order to to get this DOI. So if we know the DOI, then many metadata elements can safely be added in a missing, perhaps, metadata field that come from an institutional repository. Extra to that, Guardian does also metadata enrichment via text mining technologies that are applied also to the actual content. So for a PDF publication or for a dataset that also is accompanied with some textual information, the paper or some notes, Guardian goes inside the content and tries to extract keywords, to extract ontological terms. It tries to verify the title. It tries to catch things that are somehow easy for a machine to perform. Also, regarding findability, Guardian provides behind the scenes the mechanism for making those resources findable by popular search engines and also by Google datasets. And this, for those that are more techies, this is done by creation of AMP compliant entries and also the publication of metadata as linked open data. Regarding accessibility, Guardian has the same logic. Again, there is an entry level. We have to have some license or terms of use defined in order to get to level one of accessibility. And then it is considered that a resource is more accessible if it's more open here, or if you have if you can do more things with this resource. So in order to move from level one to level two, a resource that uses CCs or other any equivalent language gets some extra credits. If the license is more loose, then it gets some extra credits. So we move from protective, from closed datasets to more open datasets, open with restrictions and open with and open with CC0 or CC BY licenses. That means unrestricted access. Of course, at the top level, we need to have a URL to the physical files. Otherwise, we have only the metadata for that, which is okay, but not enough in order to be actually accessible. So in order to move from level 3 to level 4, there is a requirement that we have also URLs to the physical files, and also that these physical files are published along with metadata, are published in somewhere like CGIAR center repositories that guarantees their persistence, especially the persistence of metadata. In the case that a data file or a data set is not available anymore for many reasons, because whatever, at least the requirement is that the metadata should remain accessible so that nobody will forget the existence of it. Again, behind the scenes, Guardian deals then it provides many processes that runs. The first is the identification of licenses from the textual description. So if for a resource a term of use is described with all these legal documents and so on, Guardian will try to understand if it is referring to a certain license. In the case that these terms of use documents are referring to CCs and other licenses that have a machine readable representation, it identifies them and also it publishes the license information in those machine readable formats. And also at the human side, at the user interface. Guardian provides a visual indicator of the license so as to be as easy it can be for a human when he or she visits a resource to be easier to understand the license of that resource and if this is can be used commercially or not, or if this any derivatives can be are allowed, or all the other aspects that are mentioned in the license. Regarding the third FAIR principle, the interoperable principle, the logic again is the same, moving from one level to another with some extra work, either from the side of humans or from the side of the machine. Here the requirement is to use formats that are not proprietary. Fortunately, we don't have, at least we haven't observed such case across CGs. Typically, at least the data are in TIFFs, regard if these are geospatial data or CSVs, Excel files, so the formats are okay, and the publications are in Word or in PDF. So it's this is the easiest point that we have here. But in order to move from one level to another, there are again some requirements, especially the requirements that come from the use of harmonized data by the use of standard vocabularies. So here, if you use, for example, AgroVog, we consider it as something that promotes interoperability. Again, this is used in many centers, most probably because CGCore also points to all these dimensions from its different elements. Again, if you use geonames to describe a region or a country, again you it is considered from the Guardian system as something which is better to do. Or if you use domain-specific semantic resources like crop ontology, again, it is better rather than having keywords, for example, that are free. In order to move to the last, last levels of interoperability, the use of CGCore for metadata description is something which is considered something really, really good. If you have data transformed to RDF, again, you have some points, but eventually the idea is that you need, and this is what it is required from level 4 to level 5, if you publish data, it is really, really, really good to have also links to the relevant publications or vice versa. So in order for something to be interoperable, it doesn't need to have all the right formats or the right representation language or to be in RDF, but someone should be able to interpret it. So if you are publishing data, it is really, really good to link somehow also the publication, or the opposite way. If you publish the publication and you provide some links to the real data that this publication, the experimentation inside this publication has taken place, this is the true meaning of interoperability. And if this is open, also the true meaning of accessibility. And eventually, if you can find it and you have all those links between the publications, the data sets, and everything is open, then you have all the ingredients to ensure that this is likely to be reused. Behind the scenes, For interoperability, Guardian tries again via term extraction, via term identification mapping to domain ontologies that take place over the real content. It tries to help in those cases that the data managers from the different repos have already done it. It verifies the existence of the different terms. We have seen in some cases typos, and these typos Guardian corrects them, or in other cases where there is no agrovoc, for example tagging, Guardian extracts those terms and provides those additional agrovoc terms as metadata for that specific resource. The last dimension regarding reusability, this is if you recall from the beginning of this webinar, reusability is something that cannot be not measured, but cannot be modeled within a machine. So luckily, since reusability in this context is highly dependent on the ability for someone or for a machine to find a resource, to have access to a resource, and to be able to use it based on the on how interoperable this is, we have adopted a very simple rule that is observed, that is accepted also from DANS, from the Netherlands Institute for Permanent Access to Digital Research Resources, that reusability actually is a meta dimension, or it can be, at least for this context, considered as a meta dimension of the other three dimensions. So it's an average of the other three, in the sense that if a resource is easily to be found, it is open enough, well described, and is in a format that all the relevant tools can use it, then most probably it has all the ingredients, the good ingredients for also good reusability. Of course, it is also a matter of quality of the data. So if the assumption is that we are talking about a really, really good in the sense of value, how valuable data these are and how scientifically correct those data have been collected, have been reported, and all these assumptions, then there is no barrier actually that doesn't let this resource to be reused if the other three dimensions are okay. For last, for further reading, you can always go to Force 11 website and read all the theory and all and what is going on regarding the FAIR movement, and also all these images and all these guidelines can be found via Guardian as a PDF guide, and also in the web system of Guardian. So thank you, and I assume that this is the space for questions, for anything that you want to discuss with me.
Thank you very much, Pythagoras. I see that we already have some comments and questions on the chat. So let me just read them out. I'm not sure how good people's connections are. But if you look at the chat, the first question is from Biodiversity in Montpellier, and they would like to know, what ratio of human to machine intervention is used in the behind the scenes Guardian tool? I'm not quite sure. I guess it's the one that pertains to all of those dimensions that you mentioned.
Okay. The ratio is 100% automatic. So there is no observation of what the machine does. In the sense that during the first year for those services, we trained the system so as to be sure that it cuts enough terms. We have make it as strict as it can be in frequencies and all the other things that can go wrong. And we are talking the behind the scenes tools are tools that are 100% automatic, are machines that try to extract, try to combine from different sources, and the criteria are really strict. So if there is a probability of making something wrong, then it doesn't change anything, it doesn't add anything.
So Biodiversity folks, would you like to say something to that, or is that good? I guess take silence.
Hi.
Hi Elizabeth. Yes, go for it.
So the question was coming, in fact, from Milko. In fact, behind the mic, we have Celine, Michael Skovic, and myself, and Milko had that question. And I think, yeah, we were impressed that it's 100% automatic. And the thing, I was wondering if there is any step for validation, because what it means that when we can apply the so-and-so quality data set on our dataverse, and behind the scene tools of Guardian will automatically bring our data sets up to the next level, quality level, without any intervention or validation from the data managers or?
Yeah, actually, this is interesting. The direction that you describe is really interesting. And these are actually our next plans. What we plan is a series of tools, and not only the tools around extraction, but also other tools like PII checkers. Those tools will be available for the data managers as individual services to be used during the curation, because so far Guardian sits on top of the existing repositories and tries to correct whatever can be corrected. Let me use the correct, because this is okay.
I think Pythagoras, you're not talking about correcting, but so much as enriching, right?
It's enriching and correcting in the light sense. If there is a typo, for example, of an ontological term, and the machine knows exactly has the ontology and can correct the typo. This is correct. Actually, it's enriching. Yeah, but what I'm trying to say is that those services currently are running after the curation process. They observe what already exists in the different repositories of CGIAR and try to enrich whatever is there. I totally agree that if a data manager has access to those tools, and this is what we intend to open during the curation process, perhaps it will be easier for him or her even to perform the curation. If, for example, a term extractor would parse a data file or many data files or many PDFs, and you had a tag cloud of most frequent terms, it would be much easier to select from those from this tag cloud instead of going and reading everything or trying to understand everything. Or if you have direct access to the PII checker that that currently we are finishing, then you would have you will have the ability you will have an alert that will notify you that okay, let's check this at that point. Do you agree that it's in the right direction to open also the services for during the curation process?
Okay, thank you very much, Pythagoras.
Oui, oui, c'est...
Okay, I think let's move on to Hector's question. And that refers to whether, you know, whether these services will be available. For example, he says through a REST API.
Yes.
The services, meaning the process of the way the FAIR metrics are employed or deployed.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so hi, Hector. The answer is yes and yes, because I understand from your question that the question actually can be perceived from two different perspectives. One that has to do with an existence of an API that exposes those FAIR metrics for the resources inside Guardian. And the answer is yes, this already exists. And the second one has to do with a service that anyone can post a metadata record conformant to CGIAR, for example, and then get back a FAIR measurement according to those scoring system that we have internally. So for the second for the second perspective, the answer is yes, although we don't have it yet. The service exists, so we can. We have never thought that this is something useful. But if you think that this is useful also for other systems like Marlow, then we can open the service in the service pool that I was discussing earlier. It's a yes and a yes. It's a big yes.
Thank you very much, Pythagoras.
Oh,
thank
good.
You,
there you are.
Yeah, so I was keen to understand how this process works, but also, for example, we are measuring the publications, the peer review publications. So I was keen to know if I passed onto you a DOI, you can let us know if this DOI, like the different metrics for each of the FAIR principles. Would it be possible
yes.
to do that?
Yes, this is totally possible. Yeah.
Thank you.
Great. Now we have a comment from Gideon. He feels that the way the FAIR standards are implemented is confusing. Gideon, I don't know if you can get on, but it might be good for you to sort of explain why you think that, what part of it you feel is confusing, and what the alternative might be, because, you know, right now there is no way of sort of measuring this, and it's much better than calling something open. So I'm not quite sure why you say this is doing a disservice to open data, because what we're trying to do is actually help people get their stuff more open if they wish to make it open, and actually do it by a sort of a very coded sort of way of doing it, clear guidelines as to what can be done to make something more findable, more accessible, more interoperable, more usable. So if you can sort of explain your comment, that might be helpful.
Sure, absolutely. Hi, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Yeah, we have discussed this a number of times, Medha, but let me just do this for the broader group. I'm putting it really pungently in my comment, because I agree with you to some extent that having the way that these standards are being implemented is better than nothing, but I think we can do better than nothing. These standards were developed at a time when at the beginning of the of data becoming open, and when there was really nothing out there. And at that time, it definitely served a big, big purpose in making the data open and actually making data findable and accessible. And just leave it at that. Those two, findable and accessible. At that time, the people who developed those standards were really ahead of the curve in terms of identifying that it also had to be interoperable and reusable, and that those were different things than findable and accessible. In that sense, yes, absolutely. That was a really good move. Now, I think that in terms of making our data findable, accessible, interoperable, and reusable, and I think that we should actually add two more terms to it. Two more R's, or an E and an R, depending on how you want to look at it. And the R from responsible, and an R from reproducible. So you get fairer data standards. But that aside, it means that I think we should. Not just say, okay, we have these standards that were developed a couple of years ago, which were meant for for guiding people who had no idea how to make their data open access, to make them open access. We're further down the line, and we have to up our game on this. And so the findable is very much about having URLs and DOIs. So I think that a DOI in the interoperable part doesn't make sense. That's part of the findable part. So you can actually find that data. So it is the or you can have it in the access or in the accessible. It doesn't really matter. But really, define those things very clearly in terms of key things that really belong together. Right now, there is stuff in there in the different components that you say, okay, a URL and a DOI are in two different parts of the metrics. Those things should be together. They're part of the same group of concepts, namely that you can that it is it can be reached on through the internet. So those things should be together, the interoperable part is the interoperable part. I completely disagree with the way that it is it's formulated right now, because interoperability is about being able to link different data sets, which means that you need to look inside the data and provide structural metadata relevant in order to link either data sets that are of the same type. That you can add different data sets together, even though they are coming from completely different sources or parts of them, or you link disparate data sets on common criteria.
May I say something on that, because you opened many things. First of all, I totally agree with you about the discussion about reusability. For Guardian perspective, reusability follows this simple rule because of one simple reason. Whatever we try to do here, is what the machine can do. And machine cannot evaluate anything that talks about reusability, and also other dimensions like the ones that you put in the discussion, like responsible data and reproducible data. And this is a discussion, an ongoing discussion that we have with Medha, with Rodrigo Sara, also on the ethical side. I assume that when you say responsible data, it's what we call also ethical thing.
Exactly. Responsible, yeah. Or ethical. The thing is where if we go back to the world that currently the FAIR data standards are formulated, you have the licensing up there in the first part, but you really what is then happening is that, and this is something that I see happening across the CGIAR, and not only there, is that people want to tick their boxes. They want to make their data fair, because that's a good thing. So data is put into CC BY, because that gives you a lot of points, but there is a lot of data that shouldn't be in CC BY, because you're basically not adhering to international treaties. You're basically abusing human rights or other legislation, and unless you have a really good IP and ethics council to guide you, and not all organizations have that, you run into a lot of difficulty. But the
exactly, and this is exactly
providing an incentive, yeah, to do bad things by saying that CC BY is the holy grail. That's only the case for certain types of data, not for everything.
Well, but Gideon, I think we need to give our data managers and our researchers a little bit more credit than you're giving them, because I don't think everybody's just willy-nilly hitting the, you know, the CC BY button because they think they're going to get a slightly better score for F, because nobody's really, you know, frankly, no, this I'm, is a way for I'm, people I'm, to measure I'm, themselves, but I don't yeah. think that's happening to the extent that you fear.
No, point taken. But I'm trying to put it really sharply here. I may definitely be exaggerating at some point, but I really want to get this this discussion, open up this discussion in a more broader sense than just the discussions that we have over coffee the three times a year that we meet.
That's I agree with that, and I do take your point. I think you know that already, Gideon. And certainly, I've talked with you about the privacy dimension. I've talked with Pythagoras about it and how we might bring that, and we need to do something more concrete with that. I totally agree with that. So that is something that I'd like to advance on a little bit more this year. Let's table that for now. I know you don't want to hear that, but the point is that I agree, and I think Pythagoras agrees on that. Certainly something needs to be done about that. I'm not quite sure where to take the rest of your comments, but I think what we might want to do is carry them forward, certainly start a discussion on how that privacy angle could be brought in, perhaps start with that in a Skype call. And I think I promised you a Skype call a while back and didn't follow up on that. So let me follow up on that. I'm sorry about that. For now, though, we have another 5 minutes left. Now I have to jump on another meeting, and I do want to give the last question, at least the last question that's in the chat, some play as well. Fanuel, I haven't met you, and I'm glad you're here. I'll say hello digitally and read out your question, but if you would like to add to that in any way, please do. So, Pythagoras, you can see the questions there. Are the metrics or the question, are the metrics for a particular data set updated when that data set or publication of that data asset is updated in the original repository?
Yes, the metrics are updated. If anything changes, then the metrics are updated. So if a description is changing, if someone adds some extra information, if a new file is attached to as a different version in a dataset, so that new terms, for example, from the machine can be extracted, then the scoring is updated.
Perhaps you want to say a little bit how often the indexing is done, so that when people can expect.
The indexing is performed on a weekly basis. Every week, Guardian harvests all the systems that are connected to Guardian, and it takes about 10 days to complete the process of aligning everything and linking everything. So this means that you will see results in a window of 15 days. Also, so if you publish something in your institutional repository, then you will see, the guarantee is that you will see in 15 days this publication or this dataset in Guardian. And since we implement the AMP, we expect also to see it in popular search engines within a time frame of maximum 2 or 2.5 months, which is the average of Google crawlers to parse something out there.
Manuel, is that do you have any other follow-ups? Is that response, does that make sense to you? Good, great. So we've got about 2 minutes left. If there's one last question for Pythagoras, please feel free to jump in and ask it.
Yeah, Medha, this is Abhishek.
Hi, Abhi, how are you?
I'm doing great, thank you.
Good. Go ahead, go for it.
So Pythagoras, ICRI said Dataverse has around 300, more than 380 something data sets. But when I'm searching ICRI set keyword in Guardian, I'm getting only 60 hits in data sets. So
if you search ICRISAT, just a moment, you get only 60. Yes,
but you're right. If you go to dataverse.icrisat.org, you will get 348 data sets there.
Yeah. This is because when we are saying data sets from ICRISAT, we are talking about data sets that are hosted in your Dataverse account. When you search Dataverse, your search is performed over the entire Dataverse.
Over entire ICRISAT Dataverse. Yes.
Yeah. Your Dataverse is in Harvard?
No. Pythagoras. Our Dataverse is we host ourselves.
Okay, I don't have in front of me the keywords, but what we can do is that if you feel that Guardian doesn't have all the resources, then this is either because Guardian doesn't know a new system. We had that case, I think, with Hillary or with IWMI. They moved
no,
the system.
No, I think it was Icarda, perhaps. No.
Icarda. Yeah. Anyway. Yeah. Icarda. You're right. Yeah. Or because some criteria of Guardian are not met. For all the centers, we have reports that come from the system. that we can share with you with all the problems. And these problems typically have to do with inconsistent metadata. For example, if you have a DOI and that DOI refers to a different title, to a different actual resource than the one published by your system.
Okay, so Pythagoras.
This doesn't go inside Guardian. So these are mainly the reasons.
So what I will request you, you please take a case study and let us know at least about 2-3, because it's a huge difference. 60 versus 340.
So I think Pythagoras, what would be good is to share the report with Abhi, for number one. And number two, maybe we should have a Skype call with Abhi. Who would be, would it be just you, or would it be somebody, would you want to include a couple of other people from ICRISAT in this?
Yeah, like if Pythagoras send mail to me, I'll include the relevant people, including Chaitanya. Yeah.
Okay.
He's also on the call.
And the trailing question. Better to have more resources. So we are on the same side. We are always keen on having more and more data and more publications.
Yeah, because in my opinion, if you see such differences, correct picture of our open access. Like, it's not giving correct picture.
Okay.
Because anybody CG will go to Guardian and try to look. Why everybody will go to individual data versus? So
this somebody is something
wants,
that we will.
Yeah, so please have a look. And another thing that
we
do you
more
have
than
any
happy to support you on understanding.
Do you have any Git for all of this code so that we can also have a look about algorithms and then the process? And have you established any Git and GitHub account or any other so?
Yes, all the code of Guardian is open source and is included in Guardian. So if you go to Guardian, you will find the GitHub link where everything is there. It's published with an open source license.
Thank you very much. Thanks for wonderful work. Thank you.
Okay, and Abhi, I will be more than happy to dig inside the problem that you mentioned, trying to understand it and to give a solution, either if it's on the data side or if it is any problem on the Guardian side.
So Pythagoras, I guess the first thing is if you could look at the report and share that with Abhi, and then we'll follow up with a Skype call. Maybe that's the way to go.
Uh-huh. Perfect.
Yes.
Medha, Neelam here, and Pythagoras as well. Hi. So one thing, I mean, I don't know whether it would be for Guardian or, I mean, somewhere, I think it would be a good idea to include a disclaimer for the data sets somewhere in the Guardian record. When you are basically looking over the data sets, and especially for the survey data sets, from IFPRI point of view, or for other centers as well, for the socioeconomic data sets primarily, it is a good idea to have a disclaimer. And I know the Guardian records basically points to the Dataverse record, but while it is displaying the terms of use, I think at the same time, it would also point to a disclaimer language that would probably protect us from any other legal issues or any inappropriate.
Well, what specifically do you want to disclaim? Because we already have a disclaimer. So
we have a disclaimer basically for all data sets saying that the data are basically presented as it is reported from the fields, the data are de-identified, and we're not responsible for.
Okay, so Neelam, I have to leave now because I'm late for my next call. But I would encourage you to look at the bottom of the Guardian page. There is a disclaimer there, so have a look. If you think something else needs to be added to it, let us know as soon as possible. Because you're right. There should be a disclaimer. We thought about it and we did add one. But it's possible that something might, you know, from your eyes, something might be there that, or might not be there, rather, that ought to be. So let us know that right away.
Okay.
Yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Great. I'm sorry, but I'm going to have to call a hard stop on this. Or unless, does somebody else have more questions? Because I'll just drop out and I can let you guys go on with this if you're okay with that, Pythagoras, if you're okay going another 15 minutes. Do people have more questions?
Yes, I'm perfectly okay. If there are more questions, I will be happy to answer answer them.
Okay.
All right. Bye.
Take care. Thanks, Nino.
Okay, so is there any other question?
So we have two follow-ups. One is with Abi and one is with Gideon. And so we will make sure to get on that. Michelle, if you're still there, then please just kick my butt if I don't follow up on this. Okay, Medha, that's not it. Thank you. Thanks very much.
Okay.
Thank you, everybody. And thank you, especially Pythagoras. This was great. It was very helpful. I think people overall have a better understanding now, if I'm reading the comments correctly. So thank you very much for that. And we'll go forward. And hopefully, if there are other questions that you guys think of as you leave this meeting, please do. Don't hesitate. Do send them to Pythagoras. And if you copy me on that, that would be helpful so that I know what's going on. Thank you. And take
care,
everybody.
Thank you very, very much. And just to close, it was a pleasure for me to present how GARDIAN tackles fairness. And this is an ongoing discussion. So if you think that something should change, something should take a different direction, we will be more than happy to hear it and make any necessary improvements, refinements, everything that makes us also better. Thank you very, very much for taking part in this webinar.
Thanks again, Pythagoras.
Thank you for giving it. And I will be in Europe as of next week. All through the months of July and August.
Great. So we can follow up, at least start follow up with by Skype, and then take it from there. Good.
Okay, good.
Thanks. Thanks, Gideon. Bye-bye. Take care, everybody. Bye-bye.